How important are the days of your life? The days of your life, how important? Treat this day like it was supremely important. That's the way to look at it. I try to treat each day like this is the most important day of my life. By far and away. Every day, try to treat it like that. It's days of your life, right? Very important. Now, these videos are actually have a great relevance. Eventually, it will be seen. I may be able to speak even more directly to those who have a background of music, culture, art, beauty, all of that. But it's not limited to that at all. I've had a very amazing experience to relate along these lines. Had a dream last night, and I went to a movie theater. I took a friend to a movie theater. I said, "Hey, I want to show you. I'm going to treat you. This is really something. You're going to be amazed." And we went in, and I guess they're showing a movie on a screen. And the movie showed someone on a stage, and it was this diva, this lady, and she was singing, just a cappella singing. And the singing was so amazing. It made Rosa Poncel sound like a donkey. Okay. And it was completely positive. There was no like words. It was more syllabic, just syllables. And it was sort of like opera, a cappella opera, and just incredibly playful and beautiful, and scintillating and just completely amazing. Now, I woke up from this, and I was able to continue on and being awake, lying there, listening to this and composing in my mind and hearing all this singing. I said, it continues on. I can continue on and hear this. Now, my friend was not interested at all. He said, I don't get it. I said, why don't you get it? What are you talking? This is like the most amazing singing that anyone's ever heard. If you are at all an aficionado of music and singing, this, what I was experiencing, again, would make anything that you've heard look like a braying jackass. I mean, just, have you ever heard of that? You know, really, I mean, the difference is just completely elevated beyond anything you've ever heard in this world, your ears have ever heard, or ever will hear, actually, with your senses. And then I processed all this, and I said, you know what? Actually, as great as this was, the vision of oneness is infinitely better. I infinitely prefer the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness made the singing sound like a braying donkey, or jackass, or whatever brays. Really. And I said, I'd much rather have the vision of oneness. That's what conclusion I came to. And this is amazing. And I'm able to set this singing down to say, okay, you know, it's whatever. Now, the fact is I've been obsessed with several lifetimes of trying to bring this type of this singing, this music, this incredible expression, musical expression, trying to bring it into the world through composition, and then trying to help people hear this. What I'm hearing, try to find some way. I've been completely obsessed with this, I realized. It's wasted my life, not only this life, but other lives as well. And here I am now just dismissing it, just saying, I'm not going to even spend a minute on it. How about that for unbelievable progress on the spiritual path? And then I turned to the mechanism of the movie projector and the film that's projecting this on the screen. I said, let me look at this. And I began to understand that, for one, what I'd much rather see is the clear light, a movie of the clear light. Let us say there's a film strip going across in front of a shining light. And what is the film strip? It's actually different degrees of blockage of the light. And that different degrees of blockage of the light is what is actually being projected onto the screen. Now what if we had a film strip? There were still these individual film strips going through quickly, images projected quickly, which is what a movie is. Except each segment, each individual frame, of the film strip was completely clear, no blockage there. And so what if we just ran this movie through the movie projector onto the screen? So you'd be projecting this clear light, unblocked light, on the screen. Now, okay, that's simple enough. Now the question is, where do you go see this movie? What movie theater do you go see? And the answer I got was, the entire universe is the movie theater. The entire universe is the screen. The screen is everywhere. Ah. So, and the movie is called Absolute Stillness. Absolute Stillness. Now, I ask myself, would I rather see this movie or the movie of this incredible singing diva? And the answer was, I'd rather see the movie, The Absolute Stillness. Absolute Stillness. For sure. For sure. And so I said, okay, let's view this movie then. Let's move on. So this the progress that this indicates is truly astonishing and monumental and important. Because it signals the end of delay. It signals the end of delay. This diva, listening to this diva had delayed me. Which is a projection. Now, what we tried to do, as I say, we tried to create, separate from reality. What is God? God is light, the pure light, the absolute zero-dimensional, completely clear, pure light. This is reality. This is God. What we tried to do is the light gives us all experience we want. What we tried to do is we tried to get the light to block itself and to turn into something else. So we've had this dream of obstruction, of somehow light obstructing light, believing that it could lead to something different than light. This is called perception. Keep in mind that the movie strip going through the front of the projector has different degrees of blockage of light that then's projected on the screen. So as we're looking at this world and everything through perception, we're seeing all these different degrees of blockage of light. It's all a play of blockage of light. But what is doing the blocking of the light? See, this is what we've lost sight of. This is what we lost sight of. We think form is doing it. We think there's some other principle. No, it's light that's doing the blocking of light. It's all one light. It's all one light. And as I've said in the previous videos, what we need is to have this massive effort we've made to block the light, which is really only light playing with light. We need to, for light to honor this in order to set down our continuity fear. And so light honors this by showing a film called Absolute Stillness, which every frame of the film is absolutely clear. There's no blockage at all. But it is still film. It is still a film strip. And it's still individual frames going through. So it's still perception. This is still perception. Now, I had an experience maybe about a week ago of experiencing the light in a dream. And I saw how the clear light was stepped down about 5 steps, I would say, to where we are here. Or it could be in the 5th dimension, stepped down 5 times, as it were. But I could experience this step down light here in this world, it seemed, It wasn't too intense. It started out perfect, the perfect clear light, and then it was stepped down so that I could experience it here. But it was still an expression of honoring everything here. See, in this world, experiencing the clear light is too much for us. We would just vanish very quickly. We could not maintain our presence here if we were experiencing the clear light. We could not. So this film, imagine a film strip that is unblocked and clear, but imagine the film material of the film strip having some structure to it, such that the light is not the perfectly clear light that gets to us. It's visible light, as it would. It's white light, or however you want to say it. You know, it's step. The very structure of perception here means that we're able to experience it. In other words, if you had a film strip and the celluloid was not, you know, had some opacity to it, is not completely translucent or completely clear, the light doesn't get through completely unblocked. It's just completely uniform. It's totally uniform. In other words, there's no variance about it. And yet the structure of the celluloid itself is causing, you know, the light comes through and it maybe seem white or something instead of completely clear, all right? And so there are different levels of film strip, of purity of the film strip. But so that's the only difference. And I see that it's stepped down, you know, about five times here. But we can experience this undifferentiated absolute stillness. And it may seem to be a soft, shimmering golden light or something like that. Okay, however it appears to us. It's undifferentiated. Each frame is completely clear, but the material itself of the film strip may not allow the perfectly clear light. As it comes through that film strip of perception, it takes on an appearance of like white light or something like that. That's what I saw in my dream, that I saw the perfectly pure clear light, and then it stepped down into this like intense golden light, and that was stepped down to a little intense, less intense golden light, and then more, a little bit yellowish, and then it came sort of whitish, and so yellow whitish light. It was stepped down about five times. That's what I saw. But it's still what it does is honors our perception. This is how the clear light honors light, because everything is light. So this whole play is the play of light, even though we have imagined it's not. Even though we think it's the play of light and darkness. No, it's not. It's all the play of light. So light honoring light. That's what we have here. Perfection honoring perception is how we are able to then set down the film strip altogether. So ultimately, we don't even need any film strip. We don't even need any projection. We don't even need any perception at all. But that, again, is down the road, perhaps five steps or maybe five steps removed from that, which is fine. We're in no hurry. All we need is here in this world is to see this film strip of absolute stillness. There's no fluctuation of light and dark on each frame of the film strip. Each frame of the film strip is totally uniform, totally clear, totally unblocked, as best as that structure of the film strip can be. And that's as much as we can tolerate here and still remain here, actually. So, of course, you hear people saying, yes, and yes, you're enlightened, but there's beyond that, there's this, and beyond that, there's this, and beyond that, there's this. Well, it depends how that's presented. It's unnecessary if it's to one up somebody, that's not right. That's not right. It all absolute stillness experienced here is sufficient. From that standpoint, then easily you can go through the stepping down of this and move through to the clear light, which would be beyond your presence here, actually. You would not be able to be in the clear light continuously and still have a presence here. No teacher has ever done that. It's not possible. So it's silly to try to one up by saying, yeah, but there's a lot beyond that. Yeah, there's a lot beyond that. And there's a lot beyond that. Blah, 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 blah. No, that's silly. Let's just rule that out as far as one-upmanship or anything like that. Forget it. All we have to do is experience this still. Just view this movie. Absolute stillness. Now, occasionally, maybe we may go into an even less step-down experience of that. That's fine. But splitting hairs. I mean, that's not where our emphasis needs to be. That will happen naturally once we step in, we'll start watching this movie of absolute stillness. But that's not the importance of it. Splitting hairs. We can matter-of-factly be aware, say, okay. But the whole push is to actually view this movie, absolute stillness, and to realize it's infinitely better than all the other movies that we've been watching, even the high cultural movies, which is the one I just watched last night. If you want to hear great singing, the movie I watched last night will most certainly satisfy that. But you could watch that movie, you know, forever. It's just infinite playfulness. But the movie Absolute Stillness is way more profound. Because it resolves our continuity problem, which enables us to eventually embrace the clear light as it is. And then the playfulness within that clear light is so far beyond anything that perception could show us that there's no point in even attempting to even talk about it. All right? The satisfaction, the fulfillment is infinitely greater. So there's no point even trying to talk about that, except just make a note of that. That's it. The goal is to get out of that movie theater, stop watching the diva, the high cultural, and say, hey, I could waste lifetime after lifetime after lifetime on this, and just be so upset because I can't get everyone to enjoy this and understand how wonderful it is, and people. Okay, that's not how we're saved. It's not how people are truly helped. People are truly helped by realizing there is a benediction upon all perception. There is this light giving the benediction to light. This is what we really need to hear. This is what really calls us and saves us time. Otherwise, we're going to waste endless amounts of time watching these other movies that seem so entrancing. So I realized, wow, this is what's been holding me back. This is what's been the problem. Of course, easy to see that someone could become incredibly enthused about this. Now, I know in a previous life I was able to hear this singing, this music, this musicality, and I tried to bring it through in the world and compose it, set it into form, step it down into form to people would be delighted by it, etc. But this is not salvation. This does not solve a continuity problem. And it's not what we really want. It's not what we really want. It's better to focus on what we really want. The problem is in hearing this, maybe for the first time, or you start to hear that, you become so enthused because you say, wow, this is so much better than the other movies I was watching. So much better, right? And you say, I just got to bring this to the world. You know, you become on a mission. You become obsessed with trying to say, hey, people, there's this better movie. You know, watch this. Well, eventually what happens is you have experience of the vision of oneness. And then you say, oh my gosh, this is incomparably better to any of this high cultural, you know, movies that I was watching and paying attention to. And then you get clued into that this is actually what we really want, the movie we really want to watch. The other stuff is not. It's just entertainment. It's not what we really want. and then you drop. That's how I see it. So I realize that the obsession is over with me. I don't feel any conflict or struggle or like, oh my gosh, I want to keep watching that singing. I said, well, I can listen to that anytime. It's no big deal. Listen to it anytime. It's fun. It's playful. It's you know, wonderfully playful. But absolute stillness has this complete, awesome, light, blessing light. Absolute stillness. That is the one, the movie that we really want to watch. So I say, light, expedite this. Come on, expedite it, expedite it, expedite it. So this is the goal here. This is the goal here. Now, I did say in the last video that Maharaj, Nisargadatta Maharaj, or various teachers will talk about the play of consciousness. And I said, well, you know, that's just mostly chit-chat. But I need to at least modify that a little bit. What's important is the absolute stillness, is this teacher is watching this movie of absolute stillness. That's what's important. Talking about, well, the projector, the light bulb, the film strip, that in relative to the absolute stillness and the impact that you feel when you're in the presence of those who are watching this movie of absolute stillness, it's relative to that. It's not that it's chit chat, but it's important chit chat. Honestly, I have to say it's important chit chat in that it does provide some context. There is some context there. But relative to the awareness that someone is watching this movie of absolute stillness, and therefore that movie exists and you can watch it too, that is what is truly impactful. Very impactful. And then you fill that in with talk about the light, the film strip, the obstruction of the light being projected upon a screen and all that, which is all true, which is all accurate stuff. It's all accurate stuff. So it's a filler. It's a good filler. It's a good filler. It's part of the overall context of the whole situation, I would say. So that's just sort of a slight amendment to what I said. If if you're obsessed, if you're listening to this diva singing, it will be so amazing, so playful, so wonderful, like wow, is it, that you may not be able to even think about anything else. This is the problem. And I went through the most incredible disillusionment and pain and suffering trying to get people interested in this movie, and not being able to. That you gradually say, well, there's got to be something better. I don't want to just, suffer like this. Isn't there something better? How do you help people who are completely enthralled with this? That's the question. Well, I think the only way really would be to have the presence of those here in the world who are watching the movie Absolute Stillness. And somebody may at some point take a break from listening to the diva and say, well, what movie are you watching? You seem to be really having an amazing experience. And you say, well, I'm watching the movie of Absolute Stillness. And I say, huh? I haven't seen that one. And so a little bit trickles down through the cracks. It's like an ice dam. The world's like an ice dam. And eventually the ice dam collapses. And you wonder, how is that possible? Well, a little bit of trickles through, trickles through, trickles through. And you say, I wonder what... And again, like, you're unimpressed by the diva, you know. You say, I can listen to diva. As a matter of fact, in the absolute stillness, all songs are heard. They can be heard. They're all present. You're not blocking. Nothing's blocked that way. So you say, but the absolute stillness is infinitely more what I want than listening to this diva. And they may say, huh, that's very interesting. So I came across these teachers who obviously were listening to a better movie, watching a better movie than I've ever watched. And I was trying to get them interested in, hey, you need to listen to this diva, you know, this great music. And they're not interested. I said, wow. It gets you thinking, So it does help out. It does help out those who are watching this movie of absolute stillness. It does help out in a subtle way. But it's not going to immediately, people are not going to immediately drop their diva, you know, diva movie and pick up the movie of absolute stillness. It doesn't work that way because they're so entranced by it, you know. It just seems so delightful. Comparatively, but see, it's comparatively delightful. So that's the problem. But that's why everything goes so slowly. They'll say, well, yeah, well, this is so comparatively delightful to the other movie I was watching. But then I would say, well, compare this movie then with movie Absolute Stillness. See, make that comparison. That's fair. As long as you're comparing, you've got to be fair and compare it with, you know, go ahead and compare it with everything. Don't just cherry pick and say, well, it's absolutely delightful compared to some other movie. Say, well, what about all possible movies? How is it, you know, is it better than all possible? So you have to be honest and compare it. Now, maybe 16, 17 years ago, you know, quite some time ago, I had a dream of two... A young man and a young woman singing together. They were singing, harmonizing, and they're creating this tremendously beautiful harmony. And I was totally entranced by it. And I said, this is better than any harmony singing I've ever heard in the world. And I was determined to bring this harmony singing into the world somehow. And I just made this incredible effort to do so. And you might say eccentric, quixotic effort. It was so extreme, nobody understood. What am I doing? Because I heard this harmony. I said, if you hear this harmony, you'll be so delighted by it, absolutely delighted by it. And so I became, you know, obsessed with the effort of trying to do that. And wasted, you know, it's put me in this bad situation I'm in now, actually. Financially, in every possible way, I'm in a terrible situation because I was completely dedicated to trying to bring in this harmony. This sense of harmony, thinking that the world would be so delighted by it. It's so much better than anything we've ever experienced or heard. But now, the singing I heard last night was way better than that harmony singing, actually. It was just, the playfulness was astonishing. But I don't have any desire to do anything about it. So just let it be what it is. Okay, fine. Vision of oneness. Why? Because I had the experience of the vision of oneness. That's why. One experience of that is enough to break the obsession of all this, these other movies. The obsession's not there anymore. That's the power of the vision of oneness. Just one glimpse of it. And you just say, this, you know, this is what I really want to watch. This is the movie I really want to see. For sure. No other movies can compare to this one. You know it for sure. For sure. And the experience you get is different than watching the diva sing. The diva sing is delightful, and the playfulness is like, wow, that's really cool. But the vision of oneness is, there's a sense of this universal love and appreciation and fellowship and oneness and relief, and it's this tremendous feeling that everything is perfect, everything is all right forever. Total inclusiveness, effortless and all inclusiveness. So it's way, way better than, you know, any sort of artistic experience, actually. It's a profound, genuine profundity. So I can see it. It broke the spell. It broke the spell of entrancement. So you'd have to say I'm a different set. My makeup is different now than before. It's proof. It's absolute proof. Before, in hearing this type of singing, I would be 100% galvanized to, obsessed with trying to bring the singing into the world, you know. I'd probably go looking for some female diva and try to promote them and do everything possible for them to help, you know, try to find the best singer in the world and try to say, can you sing like this? And then knowing what I'd heard here in the dream, I'd be able to coach them and say, well, you know, you know, you're not quite there yet. You could be able to do this. And I'd be able to, like, be a vocal coach to coach someone to sing, you know, way better than like a Rosa Poncel, who's the best singer I've ever heard as far as a diva, you know, female diva singer in that style. I'd be able to say, no, it doesn't measure up. No, it doesn't measure up. You got to do way better than this. And I know how to at least get them to sing, you know, way better than they thought they could sing. That I would be obsessed by that. No question about it. But now, no, nothing like that. In fact, I was obsessed by that. But now I know the vision of oneness is where it's really at. That is where it's really at. And that comes through the spiritual path. That comes through listening to the Holy Spirit. Not in promoting art, trying to find the ultimate actress, the ultimate diva. You know, hitting high notes that are like so far beyond anything we've ever heard that you just say, holy cow. But it's all relative. You know, we're used to, this is the range that we have. And the range that I was hearing was just, you know, way, way beyond the range we're used to hearing. And the rapidity of the shifting of notes and the runs that she was going on, you know, were just way, way, way beyond anything we've ever heard here. Way beyond it. And the counterpoint, and to be able to, the suggestion of harmony. You know, what's even superior to harmony, like a man and woman singing in harmony, like George Jones, Tammy Wynette, or whatever, some you know, really good harmony singing, is a suggestion of harmony. Whereas this diva, the rapidity of the play of singing was such that it suggested this rich palette of possibilities. Okay, now, the clear light, the absolute stillness, is actually a suggestion of the total palette of all possibilities. The total palette of all possibilities is what you get. See, it's the complete absolute stillness is actually suggesting the full possible range of all harmony with that. Because all experience actually is a suggestion of the absolute stillness, the clear light, the pure clear light actually. This is God. It's all a suggestion of God. Now, I've always said that the best music is that which is able to leave the most room open for your own mind to suggest the harmony, right? That's why I can't stand this modern music, which is trying to impose everything upon you, like a solid block, that's very much going in the wrong direction. Very much so. That's why people enjoy like Indian music, ragas, very simple, dong, 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 dong. Your mind says, oh my gosh, I can see a whole palette of possibilities. It engages your own awareness and creativity, doesn't it? That's the genius of artists, is they're able to enable you to feel like, hey, invitation to experience. So, in listening to this diva singing, the way that she was singing, was I could feel, wow, she could have gone here, there, all the possibilities started expanding, in the palette of possibilities expanding, of expression. It's like that. And it wasn't a dramatic, like operatic thing, like singing all the miseries and strife and stuff. No, none of that was there. It was all light and positive. I said, okay, so it's better than two people harmonizing, actually. Because they're saying this is the product. Whereas in this, it's suggesting a richer palette. Now, the absolute stillness expresses this infinitely rich palette. So it's freeing us up from feeling constricted, that somehow our palate is constricted. See, what we've tried to do is constrict the palate and keep stepping down the light and say, now this is God, now this is God, and trying to shrink God down and saying that this frozen light is actual God. That is the palate that is being suggested by all our art and expression. It only relates to that frozen light. But the fact is, it's the clear light. It's the pure, clear light that is actually God. And that suggests all palettes entirely. All palettes of expression ultimately are bouncing off of this clear light, are a way of referring to that. You know, it's amazing. So what we've done is we've asked the light to freeze itself down as much as it possibly can, and then claim that frozen light is actually the greatest, that is God, the greatest expression of it. And then reference that in all our expressiveness, which is what brings us into sensuality, which is an extremely limited, you know, palette of expression. Sensuality, physicality is this, what happens when we take this ultimately frozen light as being God, is the full expression of God. Then we're locked into this physicality and our palate is unbelievably limited. Now what happens with art is you unfreeze the light a little bit and then take that as God. And then the palette of expressiveness seems much greater. But it's still incredibly, incredibly limited, actually. So what we're doing here is we're getting the big picture overview of what we did, is we tried to freeze the light down, we tried to, you know, have a separate creation for ourselves. And we have a continuity problem trying to get back to referencing the clear light, so we have this infinite palette of expressiveness. So we really, our real job is to work on this continuity problem, not to try to be artistic and max out on our expressiveness with this frozen light. That's really not where it's at. We can waste endless time doing this and be very dissatisfied, because ultimately that's what God did not create us for that. God created us to be in relation to this perfectly clear, zero-dimensional, pure spaciousness, clear light, with infinite palette that is all expressions are infinitely available and free to express at every moment. That is what we are created for. That is what our true identity is. So we're not meant to try to find all types of expressiveness possible referencing this extremely frozen light. That is not what God wants, actually. We claim it is, but it's not true. It's not true. Because we just keep repeating the staleness over and over, you know. Sensuality gets so stale, doesn't it? people just, you know, keep trying to, you know, let me, you know, throw a color here. Let me, what can we do with bodies? You know, and they just rework this over and over and over. What can we do with bodies? Thinking that this is the sum total of our expressiveness. This is where it's at. This is reality. This is the whole entire range of our palette of expressiveness is just the body. You know, that kind of thing. This is still unrepentant unawareness, folly. But the light blesses all of it, because it still is the play of light, is it not? It still is the play of expressiveness, right? But what the wise do is go for this absolute stillness, in which all palettes are suggested. But again, I said that even the absolute stillness we experience here in this realm is still stepped down. It's still stepped down several number of steps, actually, from the clear light. And yet, the palette of expressiveness that we experience here, the expansion of that, and the awareness of it seems to be virtually infinite to us. And yet there is not the motivation to, we realize, I understand that this is resolving my continuity problem. So I don't need to go out doing art and music, all those expresses. I don't need to do that. That's not the point of it all. The point of it all is to work back through the cause continuity issue and ultimately get back to the clear light as being the true ground of being. It's the clear light that is the true ground of being, that is truly God. And we need to be functioning with that clear light, the true ground of being, to truly express our being. Truly express our being. Absolutely. It's formless. It's truly formless. But it is enough here to watch the movie of absolute stillness. Again, the spiritual path is to melt the continuity problem. That's it. That's all that God calls us to. Not, you experience the rich palette, not to build some beautiful buildings, not to compose some beautiful songs, not to do this, all this, that. No, because then people will wrongly think that you've been inspired by God, and this is the full range of power. It is not true. So they do not get the full picture, and they can waste an immense amount of time, which they do in these subtler realms. You can waste immense amount of time playing with all these expressions. That's not the spiritual path. Spiritual path is to get the big picture, is to accept you have a severe continuity problem and to work on evaporating that continuity problem so that you get back to the clear light as you were created to function. So you do not become a diva. You do not become an artistic giant, etc. You forsake that. I say, no. That's wasting a massive amount of time, actually. You might have some artistic expression to play a little bit. Sure, that's possible. The real heavyweights don't even do that at all. They don't, do they? Ramana Maharshi, Nandamayama, the big heavyweights, Jesus Christ, were they, you know, into artistic expression? No, they were not. They were the ones that actually came from the clear light. The clear light does present itself here in various ways. Step down a bit, but they were still aware of the clear light on and off. You can't keep your bodily presence here if you were to enter into the clear light. So, but on and off. They go into this deeper abstraction, right? Even deeper abstraction here. They appear not to even be the slightest bit aware of any of here at all, like almost like it vanished. But we will see. I will see how it goes. Absolute stillness may not feel, you know, and that's important to do that, because that's not really the purpose. But But is it maybe a way to keep yourself grounded? That's possible. It's possible. I don't know. But again, not that important. People say that God intentionally froze all the light down and stepped it all down to have all this stuff. That is not true. It is spirit in its desire to be separate from God that desire that light be stepped down in all these different dimensions, all these different levels of expression, and etc. God didn't ask for that. A very important, fundamental difference. So many say that, no, this is all God's doing. God stepped it all down to experience everything possible. No, because the entire palette is available in the clear light, infinitely available. There's absolutely no reason for light to ask light to freeze itself, condense itself. Absolutely no reason whatsoever. All expressions are totally available in the pure clear light, the formless. So it's spirit and its desire to be greater than God, which is the cause of this light stepping itself down in these ways. So I asked the light to expedite this movie for me, absolute stillness. I am absolute stillness, the movie maybe. I am absolute stillness. There's an intuitive understanding of this within. There's an intuitive understanding, even if we can't explain it exactly. There's an intuitive understanding. I get it within. I say, I get it. Without having to intellectualize it. And those who think that this frozen light, this supremely frozen light, is God, they think, well, we have to intellectualize, we have to get it. There isn't any way to go further than this. There isn't anything further. You know, no, that's not true. So it's more important to work on it without trying to intellectually explain exactly, right? Because that just feeds this fear like that there's nothing beyond it. It's important to get the big picture. More important to get the big picture than to intellectually focus on details. So when anyone goes to a teacher, they're feeling the absolute stillness. They're feeling the big picture. They're intuitively feeling like, wow, okay, I get it. But there's a continuity fear here. And then just being aware of that continuity fear rather than trying to intellectually figure anything out is the most important teaching, is simply to be aware, like, wow, okay. I can see it. I see that this frozen light is not actually God, the true grounded being. I'm aware of this. My awareness is expanded to a bigger, much bigger viewpoint. And say, well, why am I not aware of this all the time? Continuity fear. And then simply continue to be aware. It's the continuity fear that's the problem. And don't intellectualize the experience. That's how to go fast. That's the fast way. And some great teachers say, just be quiet. If you want to really succeed, just be quiet. Sit here quietly. Don't intellectualize. That's what actually works. Fast, very fast. Is paradoxically, the more we realize we have a severe continuity problem, the faster the path goes. Because you're aware that's the only problem you really have. So all this intellectual stuff is not a problem. Not having all the details ironed out is not a problem. It's not a problem. It's the continuity fear that's the problem. And when we don't realize that, we'll spend all this time intellectually trying to iron out details, thinking that those are the problems. And you can waste lifetimes doing this, where in fact it's those are just minute little fears. They're not the real problem. It's the continuity problem that's the real problem. And the ironing out the little details is not addressing the continuity problem in the right way. So you're pretty much spinning your wheels when you're trying to intellectualize and iron out details. It's just spinning your wheels. That's why I say the mood of repentance is basically dropping into a willingness to accept that the real problem is this continuity fear. And addressing it, it gives this wow feeling. It's not an intellectual thing, it's a wow feeling. It's like, holy cow, I'm seeing a wider picture now. And the way is to keep expanding the width of the picture you're seeing. Remember I said that the movie theater of this absolute stillness that's being shown is the entire universe that we're perceiving. Entire universe. The theater and the screen, that's the screen is everywhere. See, that's a bigger picture than thinking of, where's the movie theater? I need to go to find the movie theater where this movie's being shown. You're in the movie theater. You're always in the movie theater. That's a wow. See, that's a wow experience. It's not an intellectual experience, it's a wow experience. The mood of repentance is neither intellectual nor emotional. Neither one. Nor what you'd call feeling or thinking or any of that. It's not any of that. Because then you think, well, the people who are more naturally towards feeling and emotion, they're getting it and the intellectual's not. No, neither is getting it. It's more of a wow feeling. It's just this wow feeling. That's what it is. It's not an emotional feeling at all. It's like holy cow. Like, wow. It's like a stunned feeling, is what it really is. It's a stunned feeling. It's not love and gratitude and, you know, oh, I'm so... See, you can tell. There's two ways that people go, that they go to a teacher. They either over-intellectualize it or over-emotionalize it. Both are the same, two sides of one coin. Two sides of one coin. Both of that is overlooking the continuity fear. When in the mood of repentance, you're neither this nor that. You're being stunned. As you feel sort of this, I neither want to think intellectualize nor feel emotionalize it. Neither one. It's just, holy cow, wow. This is profound. This is really profound. It's like feeling, it's a feeling like this is really profound. So it is, I call it the wow feeling. It transcends description or explanation or reaction. Don't react to it. You just abide in it. Just tolerate it. It's like the door's open. It's like, wow. The whole world's a theater. Wow. I'm always in the movie theater for the movie Absolute Stillness. I can't not be in the movie theater. It's always being shown on the screen of everywhere. It's So it's a shift. It's a wow shift. You know, it's a paradigm shift. And there's two ways you disengage from this wow feeling. Is you either overemote, gush about, I love you, girl, you're so wonderful, let me hug you, I'm in love with you, I just feel so much gratitude. That's disengaging from it. And, well, intellectualize again, say, okay, now, well, exactly, you know, what is the mechanism for this? And intellectualizing it, go into engineer mode or something. Both of those are disengage from it, is disengagement from it. It's kind of like you're getting such incredible great news, you don't even know how to react to it. And so just stick with that. That is the reaction. No reaction is the reaction. It's kind of like your problems are suddenly, you realize that suddenly there are no problems. It's only the absolute stillness. And to try and say, well, how do I express this in the terms of the old boundaries that I thought? That's irrelevant, isn't it? Because you realize those boundaries are not there anymore. So the question is, how do I express this, you know, in the old way? It's not necessary. You know, how can I step this down into physicality? How am I going to? No, it's not like that. So the mood of repentance is this quiet mood. As I say, it's not either quote unquote masculine or feminine, no yin yang to it actually. No yin-yang to it. It's kind of like you're stepping beyond the yin-yang. So why do you need to express that in the yin-yangness? You don't need to. It's a great relief. You realize you don't need to express it. Because it's here, now, everywhere. Expression is say, well, what do I do when I don't see it? How can I experience it when I'm not experiencing it? Which is relating to stepping down light, isn't it? You don't need to. All light wants us to do is to experience this. It's benediction, it's blessing, it's honoring. Just experience it. That is the appreciation of it. Experiencing it is the appreciation of it. That is how you express it, is to experience it. That is the expression, your expression. Not to say, oh, light, thank you so much, I love you so much. Yeah, but are you experiencing it? Or are you just detached from it in order to thank me? Don't detach from the experience in order to thank light. That's obviously trying to step light down again. But that's not it. Experiencing it is the expression of it. That is the palette on the way back to clear light. Experiencing the absolute stillness at the level where you are, where you feel comfortable. That is the expression. That is the expressiveness of the palette that you want to express now. is to actually experience it, because that melts the continuity fear away. And that is an honoring of by experiencing it, viewing it. The viewing of it, the attention to it, is the expression. Because that opens us up to the palette of experiencing even a more profound absolute stillness as we go through the steps of light unfreezing itself, experiencing the unfreezing of light, as it were. So you experience the total richness of it right here, right now. Your attention is on that. So your attention on it is the expression of it. We don't need to lapse into singing and clapping and all these things. No, stay in the mood of repentance. Stay on the path. Stay on the expression of honoring, being honored. You're being honored. When you're being honored, it's your duty, responsibility to put your attention on the ceremony, the honoring. You're being honored. You know, if you're the guest of honor, and there's a ceremony honoring you, you don't jump up and start singing and dancing and clapping and, I love what you're doing, you know. Great, wow, that's fantastic. Hey, can I, you know. You're quiet. You're appreciative. Your attention is on. The ceremony is honoring you, right? It's like that. So when you accept that you're being honored, then you are willing to go into this mode of attentiveness, instead of trying to give physical expression in some way. Again, so imagine someone who's being tremendously honored. They're the guest of honor, and there's this tremendous, beautiful honoring going on. Do they jump up and start saying, you know what, let me tell you a joke here. I like to sing a song. I like to tell you how wonderful I think, how much honored I am by your honoring and stuff. No. It's our turn now to be honored by the light. We've been honoring the light by all of this attempt to step it down and have a separate creation. Now it's our turn to be honored by the light. So now we get to view this honoring, experience this honoring. We're being honored. We're the guests of honor now. Different thing, right? We are the guests of honor. So we're quiet. We're quiet. The guests of honor doesn't jump up and steal the show and say, well, no, I want to honor you. You know, let me do the honoring. No. They say, okay, I'm going to accept being honored. This is the difference. This is the difference. See, now, in hearing that dream last night of the singing, maybe I was being honored. It's possible. There's a way that the dream concocted a rationale for it. Maybe that was light starting to honor me, to, you know, possible. Because of my willingness to accept it. And so I was just quiet and I just listened. I didn't jump up on the stage and start singing with the diva, say, hey, let's harmonize, you know, let's do. No, I just sat there and listened. Big difference. It's like it's your birthday. People are saying happy birthday to you. You don't jump up and say, no, wait a minute, let me sing happy birthday to you. When is your birthday? Let me say, no, you see, that's inappropriate. Tell you that the movie Absolute Stillness is the one we really want to accept. We have to get to that point where we're willing to be honored in such a way. We have to have the right background for that, the right understanding that we're the ones who are being honored. So it's our birthday. Let light sing happy birthday to us. Don't try to jump in. Accept the honoring. You're being honored. Thank you. And that's through realization we have a severe continuity fear. So that's humility. See, humility, we have a severe continuity fear. So we need to be honored by the light. So just let this process, you know, take place. And so it could be that when we're ready for it, it will happen. They say when you're ready for the guru appears. The guru is just a form of light that is there to honor you, actually. It's the guru that's honoring you. And it only happens when you're willing to, it's the guru singing happy birthday to you, really. And you'll be willing to listen to it and say, thank you. And don't jump up and say, hey, let me sing it to you too. And you know, no, see, that's not it. Sometimes the guru shows up in dreams in various forms, like maybe this diva was there singing happy birthday to me. And this, you know, most beautiful singing I've ever heard by a long shot. I didn't jump up and say, let me sign you to a contract. I'm going to coach you. I'm going to make money off you. No, I just said, thank you. Wow. Okay. That's great. Just let it be just like that. So sometimes in dreams, episodes of light may show up in beautiful experiences in your dreams. That's honoring you. You're being honored. Light is honoring you. Light is honoring our play with light, even those that attempt to find a way for light to not be light. It was still this incredible play with light, and so light is now honoring it to solve the continuity problem so we can get back to pure light. And so our job is just to be the honoree. See, so I'm not trying to step the music down and compose it. That's not the purpose of it. Yes, the purpose is to be honored, and there's more honors to come. So it's a program. So you have to be the good honoree and say, okay. Next, you know, okay. Now here, what's coming next? I don't know what's coming. That's why I say I don't know what's coming next. But it's been a progression of more and more blessings, more and more blessings, more and more clarity is coming. And again, continuity fear, acceptance, I have a continuity fear, mood of repentance enables this blessing, it's the mood of being an honoree. Let's put it that way, there's another way of putting it. It's the mood of being an honoree, acceptance, I am the honoree. I am the honoree, I'm the one being honored. So don't interfere with the process, let it happen. Don't jump up and say, hey, I'm so inspired by that song. I'm going to see if I can teach everybody how to sing that song. No, that's not being the honoree. That's not getting it. Because the next phase of this honoring is coming, and you'll short-circuit the whole thing. So if you take it, the honoring, appropriately, the next will come. So what's next? I say, what's next for me? I don't know. I have been honored greatly in this life by incredible experiences of beauty with like flowers and flower petals and in many, many different stages of music. And now it's getting greater and greater and greater. And I'm sort of getting, you know, how to be the honoree. I'm getting it. That's what we all have to learn is how to be the honoree. Accepting, okay, I'm the honoree. And then the blessings just pour in, more and more and more. And people say, my gosh, you're so blessed. You know, why you're so blessed? It's because I accepted the role of honoree and learned what this role is, accepted it, rehearsed it, practiced it continuously. Be very humble. Humility. I have a severe continuity problem. This is just the cure. I'm just taking the medicine for the continuity problem. That's all I'm doing. That's it. That's the key, is say, look, I've got an incredibly severe problem, and this is just the medicine I've got to take. That's all. And I know there's stronger doses I've got to take, so and I've got to take them quickly, so I'm not going to waste, you know, a lifetime of freaking out and trying to reciprocate. Oh, let me learn how to sing like that. No, just appreciate it. Say, okay, what's the next dose? What's the next dose of the blessing? I'm sure something, a stronger dose is coming. So the good teachers really teach us how to be the honoree. Mood of repentance, sit quietly. How to sit quietly. How to accept this blessing in good grace. And repent, say, God, I know what I've done. This is what I've done, tried to do. I know now I have a severe continuity problem. There's no question about it. I'm afraid to accept the clear light as clear light. I'm only used to step down light, thinking that is God. That's all there is to it as far as it goes. So obviously I have a very severe continuity problem. Would you please help me with that? And then the Holy Spirit helps you with that, saying, look, this, you need to be the good honoree. You need to play the role of the honoree now, and the light will bless you and honor you, totally honor you. But you need to go at it step by step by step. This light will be our stepping stone. I'll be your stepping stone. As long as we're willing to understand what's going on. And when we understand what's going on, then the blessings keep coming more and more and more and more and more. So I don't know what the next blessing is. But I'm ready for it. Okay, hopefully this video gives you a little bit of help. And, you know, just trickles in. Ah. Okay, I need to play the role of the honoree. Okay, how do I do that? You see, that's what brings the blessings in. That's what brings the true blessings. Whatever form may come, they may come in a form of a physical guru, or no, a physical teacher, or no physical teacher. Maybe it comes in dreams. Maybe it comes from epiphanies. Maybe it comes from, you know, I see the vision of oneness now. You know, it can come in whatever way it comes. A blessing can be a more formless type of blessing. It all depends. Maybe some don't need the actual form of the teacher here. That they can be, it's not necessary anymore. That's possible. That's probably even, well, I don't know, six of one, half a dozen of another. Just stay in the mood of repentance. I am the honoree. I am the good honoree. Let me not try and steal the show. It's light's show. It's God's show that's honoring. The pure light is honoring the entire play of light that we've been engaged with. Okay. All right. See what's next. You know something's going to be next, for sure. I'm just not sure what, but you'll find out here. Well, that's it.